changes over the last few decades. We used to have Fairless Steelworks in this neighborhood, and now it's down to only a few hundred or less than 100 jobs. We used to have thousands of people working at Roman Haas, and now there's only a couple hundred there at best. We used to have Dial Soap in Bristol, and it's completely gone. We used to have 3M just a few blocks from here, and they've all picked up and left. Don't get me wrong, this is still a great place to live. But we're still losing a lot of jobs to outsourcing, downsizing, and generally tough times. Even those of us that still have jobs find that our health care costs are going up, our gas prices are going through the roof, and our salaries and pensions just remain the same. Bristol and Levittown can be great again. We have smart, hardworking people here that want to give their kids a better life. We can turn things around in Levittown. We can turn things around in Pennsylvania. But first, we have to turn things around in Washington. Judgment to keep us away from terrible free trade deals that ship our jobs overseas. We need someone with judgment to cut middle class taxes and not millionaire taxes. We need someone who will watch out for the little guy and fight for the jobs, the affordable health care, and the quality education that's so important for our kids. Someone who understands what regular folks are going through. Someone who grew up in a single-parent home and went through tough times himself. We need someone who will stand up for us. Because I really don't care how the media and the spinners try to divide us by race or by gender or anything else in this campaign. Barack Obama is for all of us. Barack Obama understands communities like Levittown and Bristol, and he'll fight for us every day in Washington. And ladies and gentlemen, that's why I'm proud to introduce you to the next president who will help Levittown bloom again, ladies and gentlemen, Barack Obama.
Honestly, wow. Thank you so much. Thank you. What a wonderful reception. I am so grateful to all of you for taking the time to be here. Sorry we're running a little bit late. First of all, I want to thank Paul Heppel for the wonderful introduction. Please give him a big round of applause. I also want to acknowledge, I believe he's here, William Hawes, the Truman High School principal. Ellen Budman, the superintendent of schools. I want to acknowledge State Representative Anthony Malio. And also, I want to acknowledge, although he is not here today, one of my best supporters, one of the finest congressmen that we have. Congressman Patrick Murphy. Patrick couldn't make it today, so he did what I do when I can't make it. I sent the better part of my family. And so we got Jenny Murphy and Maggie Murphy right here. Well, listen, thank you so much for the wonderful reception. I've been running for president for about 15 months now. And what that means is that there are babies that have been born and are now walking and talking since I started running for president, including me. And when I announced that I was running, there were people who said, you know, why are you running so soon? Why are you running this time? You're a relatively young man. You can afford to wait. And I had to explain, look, I'm not running because of some long-held ambition. I'm not running because I think it's my turn. I'm running because of what Dr. King called the fierce urgency of now. There's such a thing as being too late. And I think that hour is almost upon us. Yesterday in the Senate, I sit on the Senate Foreign Relations Committee and had the opportunity to question General Petraeus and Ambassador Crocker about a war that has now lasted longer than the First World War, the Second World War, or the Civil War. A war that has cost us more than 4,000